Ну, у нас почти кворум. Вот ждем. Все, можем начинать.
Okay, we can start. We have one person still missing. So why have we come here today? So good morning to all of you. I hope you had enough sleep and hope you are in good mood. So we have our panel session on the National Enterprise Initiative. I'd like to remind you on what happened in 2012. The Russian President Vladimir Putin promoted this initiative, and so we are looking at the progress. You might have seen the rocket engines, and perhaps this is the way forward for us. So we'll have a substantive discussion on the 12 roadmaps, 12 areas, which has hands-on, not just theoretical, practical measures to improve investment climate. They're aimed to simplify procedures, to make life easier for enterprises. So that's something we've been talking a lot all the time, but today we're going to share some case studies. So while we were preparing for this study, so if we look at the doing business rating, Russia rose from 120th to the 51st place. So I think it's a great success. So we'll start with you, Mr. Avetisyan. So before we continue this progress, we need to draw some conclusions on what has been done and what needs to be done going forward to push that progress forward. So good morning to all of you. Good morning, Dmitry. Now before I reply to your question, I'd like to share some good news with all of you. The other day, a new draft was adopted of the roadmap on energy, finally. Why do you say finally? So this roadmap has a lot of new simplified measures on connecting to the grid, because the instruction was done last year, and it had to be adopted by May. And the deadline was missed, but so this September it has been finally adopted, and I hope that Mr. Pekin, who is part of the group on energy infrastructure, he will give you more precise information on that. So I'd like to ask the audience, do you know what's the National Enterprise Initiative? Well, I can see that most of you know, some don't, but most of you know, so we'll be on the same page. So just to remind you, let's watch a video clip. Well, it just, so you can see that this document has been designed for a specific company. The system is really closed. It doesn't help, it doesn't benefit the people. There are so many agencies that you need to go to. You know, it's the rubber stamp job that I have, really boring. Entrepreneurs often face issues, but we found a solution. The National Enterprise Initiative features a lot of projects promoted by the business community to simplify procedures of doing business. There are several roadmaps which allow business leaders to assess the business climate in Russia on a number of key areas. The National Enterprise Initiative was launched in 2012. There are 12 roadmaps, and overall 933 events, 475 regulations have been passed, 52 ministries and agencies are a part of the job, and 85 regions. The business community is part of the working group that assesses results. This is the only way to get information on the enforcement of regulations. The agency has tools to do that. We have 12 working groups. We do regular surveys of entrepreneurs. This a total of 200,000 respondents. We discuss the results in the biggest forums in St. Petersburg, Krasnoyarsk, and Sochi. We have the Leaders Club, we have a special working group under the Government Commission on Economic Development and Integration. Based on the data that we received, we're drafting further proposals to ease business, doing business in Russia. Registration of companies has been simplified, and there is a possibility to do it online. Connecting to a power grid has been simplified, and special business trip certificates, business trip cards have been cancelled. There's a mandatory share of purchases that state-owned companies have to make with SMEs. Customs duties could be paid online. There's a special Russian export center, one-stop shop for exports. There is a fully digitalized system for state registration of land ownership rights. Thanks to the implementation of these roadmaps, Russia surged from 120th place to the 51st place in the World Bank's Doing Business report. But it's too early to rest on laurels. Entrepreneurs signaling that there are new problems in terms of getting access to water and heat systems. So that's why we need to continue this job. Now, if this mechanism is successful, then we need to improve it and enhance it. And we can use many of the successful solutions to resolve new tasks. Well, as you can see, it's been a long road, and more than 700 regulations have been passed, and there are still 200 in the pipeline. So we have a new roadmap on corporate governance. We have added some of the stuff on access to heat and water systems. But certainly it's not the number of documents that matters. It's very important to monitor the enforcement of these measures. And this tool that we have, these purchases that we do by the Leaders Club, it plays a critical role. I'll give you one case study. We have this registration card. So we have a 10-day deadline. So we did some purchases, and in Moscow, Astrakhan region, it really works. But in St. Petersburg, it took between 20 to 30 days, which is much longer than 10 days. But the situation has improved since then, and I'd like to thank Mr. Vasiliev. So he's deputy head of a registry agency. He went on to St. Petersburg to resolve that issue. So that's the success of our control purchase, as we call it. I'd like to thank everyone who was part of this group. And I urge everyone to become ambassadors of the business community. You can become a mystery shopper. And certainly we promise you that we will preserve the anonymity of this process. You mean so that you don't become a foreign agent? Well, that's a joke. And now, before we move on to the practical part, I'd like to introduce the panelists. We have Igor Vasiliev, the acting governor of the Kirov region, Leonid Kazinets, chairman of the board of the Barclay Corporation. So we also have Pavel Romanov. So he'll talk about land registration. We also have Mr. Pekin, who is the head of the Energy Development Foundation, and he will talk about connecting to the electricity grid. We have Mr. Rybnikov, head of the analytical group of the Ernst & Young company. So let's talk about connecting to the grid. So it's like 9 months that this initiative has been promoted, and there are some results. So I'm sure you'll tell us on what has been done, but has it been really simplified? What has become easier to do? Thank you so much. Good morning to all of you, colleagues. Indeed, it has become easier to connect to the grid, and here's one indicator. Very often, consumers on their side, on their end, don't have enough time to comply, to do what they have to do. Sometimes connection to the grid happens really fast, really faster than consumers are prepared to do. So 30 to 40% of consumers don't have the time to do what they have to do. But the price, the costs of connecting have also come down. So we started almost from the bottom of the doing business rating in terms of connecting to the grid, but the progress has been made, and progress has been outstanding. So we reported to the government, and some laws were passed, and a lot has been done by the companies themselves. The companies have improved their governance. Some of the companies, especially those presented in Moscow, like Moesk and Alen Energo, they've been involved in that, and certainly they were exposed to the doing business rating. And they enhanced their operations much faster than the laws were changed. And that's why consumers were able to get a faster and more efficient connection to the electricity grid. And as the previous panelist said, we're also talking about gas, natural gas system. Sometimes we're talking about queues of several years in terms of getting connected to the natural gas network, and sometimes it's much more expensive than connecting to the electricity grid. But that's only in some regions. But overall, I must say that there have been regions that have done a great job, and We set up another working group to monitor the investment climate in terms of connecting to the grid in the Russian regions. And we'll have a meeting in October, and it will share some of the new measures that need to be implemented by the Russian regions. Right now, we're talking about up to 140 days, but it should be like no more than 90 days. So I hope that the work that we've been doing will be really beneficial for everyone. Well, thank you so much. So we are talking about creating a mechanism that consists of several components, and it's very important to assess whether it's enforceable, whether it's efficient, and certainly you need to understand how coordinated, how integrated are all these roadmaps. You can talk a lot about paperwork, but and progress in one roadmap, but if you don't have progress in another roadmap, then it would be impossible to reach that progress. So what about construction? Do we have any progress here? And for that, I would like to pass the floor to Mr. Kazinets.
Thank you. The construction roadmap is something everybody knows very well. We've presented it several times, and there's been progress made. The biggest achievement is that 61% of construction experts recognize the situation has considerably improved in the past 2 years. Some things have ridiculously not been resolved. We have not done away with the with some improper categorization of land, and the law on industrial areas is a useful one, but it works through a stick rather than a carrot. So I believe that it may work, but maybe some tax incentives would be more efficient. And we keep talking about it and discussing it. We keep saying that the version adopted by the government, we have contributed a lot to it, and we interact with the other roadmaps because it's issue number two for constructors, where land is, number three, where the procedures are and what the procedures are and where you connect to. But 40% of the experts do not recognize that things have improved. I think it is very difficult to influence on actual companies that implement plans on the ground, in the field, and we try to compare why in some areas developers feel well, whereas in others they don't, and how it works. It's strange that things differ, although we have a uniform national legislation. So little can be done from the perspective of federal legislation, and we are now preparing a large-scale study we're going to present to the State Council for the investment attractiveness of the regions. But one of the things that has been just confirmed at the Sberbank lunch, the role of municipalities has increased considerably, and you cannot reach out to the head of a small locality or community from the federal level. So I think it's up to the governors, mayors, and municipal heads to carry on with that. So Sberbank, it was said at the Sberbank lunch that the regions should be given more leverage for these things. So far, there are disincentives in the form of federal budget donations, and local officials don't care if you tell them, I will leave your region for another one if you interfere with my business operations. And it should be done so that, I mean, things should be arranged in a way that they should fight for business entities staying in their regions. Of course, when it's something like Gazprom or another system or company town forming entity, they will fight for that. But as soon as they can see what contribution the local businesses make to the regional taxes that they can use, keep and use, we need to go on improving the legislation. One should never believe that the laws are perfect. We are going to continue working on the roadmaps, but a roadmap is only one wing. A bird will not fly with one wing only. So we need to put the officials in a situation when they're motivated, sincerely motivated to support local businesses. You can see from reports sent in by some officials that they overcomplicate various licensing procedures. But as soon as they feel they need to fight for their local businesses, then things will go better. You have touched on a very important issue. Sometimes regional officials say we can do anything if you provide conditions for us, but if conditions are created in troubled waters, it is very difficult to make any progress. I think that the results of international ratings in terms of ease of business or international or investment attractiveness and so on, these are the starting points for federal laws to start working. They are in, they're no more, no longer an impediment. They are the necessary, they have created the necessary conditions, but what we actually need is for every official to be vitally interested in their area to be attractive for investment. So let's talk about another big problem, the registration of title to property, and I think great progress has been made here in terms of ratings. We rate at top in the World Bank list. I mean, among the we rank eighth in the World Bank's list in terms of property title registration. Now we are having here Pavel Romanov of the Land Development Enterprise. So tell us more about the registration of property through internet, using internet services. I'll talk about e-services later. So please look at this at this slide. This is the traditional paper form of registration, and next with those red stamps and marks, and next to it is what you need to do electronically to get registered. What does the red stamp mean? Well, it's a rudiment or something which should really be done away with in registration process. In 2012, we need to answer answer three questions. What are we having, and what we were having then were long waiting lists for registration. Second, the service was delivered not only to entrepreneurs but also to individuals, municipalities and government authorities, so we needed to cover entrepreneurs alone and see what could be done about them, because they were in different conditions than individuals or others. And then thirdly, we needed to formulate our objective or target, that is what we wanted to achieve by 2018. The problem was complicated, and we needed to do something right away for entrepreneurs, so we had to identify the disease, and phase one was to see what we could do quickly and without much funding. As a matter of fact, we identified that as the implementation of the accessibility principle under the federal law. Government services should be accessible and affordable. Now, as regards what we wanted as a target, we fantasized a bit, and this is the picture we drew. In 80% of the cases, after analyzing most of the typical deals, most often things are pretty standard when a land plot is purchased. So there should be a service that entrepreneurs would be willing to use, like a personal profile and an e-signature, because all the countries in the top ease of business list are advanced in e-technologies. Lastly, the procedure should be simplified. An entrepreneur should be sitting in front of a computer and has to fill out a simple form with the register number to be entered for the entrepreneurs and the entrepreneurs. Activity, or line of business, and then that application should be complemented with the model agreement taken from the Ross Register website, complete with an e-signature and certification of confirmation of payment, and within one day you should receive a reply confirming the registration of the deal. That was the target model we fantasized about in 2012, and it is not a fantasy in many other countries. In New Zealand, it takes just one step and one day and a small government duty. Then, to carry out the plan, we had to phase it. So accessibility was the task for 2012-2014. What we did was to shorten the lists of the necessary documents to be submitted, and more access points were assigned, like services when you are visited in your office or electronic waiting lists, and the one-stop shop center to file your application for registration. And now we set the time limit of 10 minutes waiting time if you visit a center in person. Most people should only need to visit the one-stop shop center. Of course, we were aware of the possible risks for underfunding. Now, the second phase was 2015 to 2016, when e-government services were only what it took. And so far, we have implemented the following. We've got four basic services: cadastre, registration, title registration, and starting from January 1st, there will be just one uniform register, and the technique will be also the same, reporting and registration in the cadastre. And of course, people had to be free from going anywhere.
So you could get what the information that you needed online. We also have two websites, and certainly for a fee, just 2 rubles, that's nothing, and then you get an e-signature, and then you go to the state registry website and get all the information. So the cadastral website was available since 2011. And right now we can use e-signature to file all the documents for estate land registration. That was first available in 2015, and it's gaining ground, it's becoming more popular. So far the share of online applications has been 2.2, and I hope that it will reach about 5% by the end of the year. So experts say that it's becoming more popular, and Russia's biggest bank is Sberbank has one-stop shop. It provides its mortgage services, and people use those services, just at the office of Sberbank. They don't need to go anywhere. They use online services. We're also monitoring the real estate market. You can get information about real estate. Also, since the 1st of September, we have a special personal profile of the title owner, and you can see what's happening to your property, and you can track all the services, you can get all the services through that profile, and further going forward, we'll add more services that I've referred to earlier. And we also have text messages, we have email notifications, so you don't need to go anywhere. You order a service and the notification is sent via email. So 70% of all services have to be done online by 2017, and there should be just 2 procedures. That's the maximum. As for the problem, the penetration of e-signatures, it has to be single for all state services. This issue has not been resolved yet. We still have to draft a typical standard agreement, a contract that could be used. And certainly we could also work on making it more customer or user friendly. And now what's happening in 2017, 2018, we're getting closer to that ideal world. We need to have a just a single database on real estate. It has to be trusted. It needs to be sustainable. It needs to operate on its own. It has to contain all the information that you'd be getting from courts, from public notary. And all that information has to trickle down into that single registry. We should have a special automatic service when the examination is done, you know, almost automatically with little interference from humans. And we have to also enforce the principle of extraterritoriality. And so that you can register your property. Well, the main goal is to save the forests, you know, so that we cut on using on paper use. Yeah, we don't need to print out something. Just press one button on your laptop and that's it. You get everything. Well, I'm sure that our next speaker, Mr. Vasiliev, the acting governor of the Kirov region, could tell us more about it. So you are, as a regional leader, have been doing a lot. And does it really benefit the economy of the region? Do you have any specific issues that you are facing? Certainly, every region is unique. But what's the situation in your region? Thank you so much for the opportunity to speak here today. And I've been the acting governor for just 1 month. I've never worked as governor. And unfortunately, there are no courses for governors. So the experience that you know, that's a task for the leaders club. You need to draft and to create new courses. So in a year, I hope I'll be reporting on success in our region and will tell you more about the case studies. I used to work in the state registry system before. So certainly, the previous speaker said the state registry decided to cooperate with the Agency for Strategic Initiatives. There are a lot of initiatives speeding up the time that's needed to get the services. But there was one more goal. The quality of examination, of legal examination, has to remain the same so that we would not damage the reputation or any commercial interest of our customers, even if it's done online, if there is little human interaction. And we've been able to do that. How? Okay, I'll tell you how. So at first, we set up a special expert council. We had representatives from the Leaders Club, from the Agency for Strategic Initiatives. We had investors, representatives from regional authorities, from Moscow, the Moscow region, St. Petersburg, the Rostov region, and the Krasnodar region. And so we had also people from the executive office of the president, the expert community. Everyone who was involved in the registration process, we drafted a roadmap, and it was really transparent. Certainly, some of the feedback was done anonymously, but you know, we set up that group. We invited entrepreneurs, and the officials marked out those areas where the laws were missing, where practices were missing, where something was wrong. And we gathered every 3 months, every quarter, and so we often had to remark those areas which were red to green. So we had a lot of progress. And I hope that we'll have more areas that would be green. And I'd like now to make a transition to regional policies. I think This is the only way to monitor the implementation of the roadmap in the regions. We definitely need the leaders' clubs' participation. We need the developers' participation. We need the management companies that are the middleman between the providers of heat, of power, and the and households. We need to monitor the situation. Unless we do it, we won't be able to implement either of the roadmaps. So we need to have a straightforward, honest discussion. I once went to a region, we had a debate, and there was a policeman outside of the room. And the moderator said, are there any questions? And you know, someone wanted to ask a question, and the policeman came over and grabbed that man and threw him out of the room. Well, that was a nasty situation. And certainly, you can have awkward questions, but we need to have an open discussion. People need to ask questions. Everyone needs to join in, to have their say, to provide their input. And in this case, the implementation of roadmaps will become a priority. It will help to improve the investment climate in the region. And that's all about property protection. It's access to credit. It's access to power, the power grids, everything what we've been talking about. So if we do that in every region, if we monitor the roadmap, if we draft new roadmaps, that is the way forward. And I agree with the panelists of the business breakfast with Sberbank. Does it make sense? They asked whether it makes sense to raise taxes. There was a lot of debate about it. But for me, the bottom line is that one thing that could be successful in the Republic of Tatarstan will not be successful in the region of in the Aral region, for example. So we need to identify the key competencies of the regions, the key advantages of every region, competitive advantages. So I've looked at many areas, and if specifically of the Kirov region, you have heard about the Kirov Les case, there was the huge scandal, the scandal over the Navalny case, the popular blogger. But in 1943, you know, penicillin was first produced here in that region for the first time in the world. And a couple of years later, it started to be produced on an industrial scale. So biotechnologies have been traditionally well developed here, and machine building. So we have a lot of plants and facilities that are part of the Almazantei Corporation, of the Rostec Corporation. They produce the state-of-the-art weaponry. It's fifth in dairy production in Russia. But we've only heard about the only stereotypes that we have about the Kirov region is Navalny Jr., Navalny the Senior. So I think we need to identify key competencies, the competitive advantages of that region. So if we have 16 million of forestry, then certainly it's obvious and natural for us to supply wood. Oh, and certainly the furniture industry is very well developed. And these are not foreign companies, you know. These are companies that are not even in the capital of our region. These are companies just outside of the city of Kirov. They are in a smaller city, and they're very well known. You can find those brands in any major shop here in Moscow or in Sochi. So if we focus on developing those companies, they could help shape the business climate and investment climate. So I urge everyone, entrepreneurs and developers who need access to grid, who are interested in improving the policy so that it's more open in urban development. I urge everyone to join the debate. We need to set up councils that would draft new roadmaps. If something is still marked red, then we need to improve it. But if we don't have the key competencies, if we don't have the personnel to do that, then perhaps we shouldn't waste our time and resources on it. Like the things that we talked about early in the morning, we spent a lot of money on setting up an industrial park. We spent 500 million, but we created only 8 jobs. So this is the rate of efficiency that we have. So I'm sure you know that hundreds of families could have lived off those 500 million for a long time. We could have used that money in a much more efficient way. So that's the way forward for our region. I would like to request the Agency for Strategic Initiatives and the Agency for SMEs to do this job in a balanced, open, transparent way. And we as regional authorities would all provide support. We would not block any of your initiatives. We would not use money just for the sake of using them in some schemes. So this, the implementation of the roadmap is all about improving the investment climate. But we need to focus on the areas where we have the key competences, where we have the expertise and competitive advantage, where we have the qualifications. We have educated staff from R&D, training, and production. If we have this full cycle, if we focus on those areas where we have the full cycle, we will be successful. And just like we've been successful in the State Registry Agency. So we certainly we are facing an uphill battle. We used to be on the 52nd place overall in Russia, but we became 8th across Russia. But certainly the federal government helped us a lot, and the Agency for Strategic Initiatives helped us. It also interpreters and the State Registry Agency were involved too. And like you said, in St. Petersburg, you know, sometimes the deadlines were larger.
We had the courage to listen to all those criticisms and take it to account, and then they began to praise us and even invited to Washington for us to share our experience. And I think I've managed to convince people in my authority entity that we would probably do better if we could borrow some money from the World Bank, and this has been really supported. I would finish with this subject, and 1 year from now I will tell you more about how I managed to arrange that and what I've managed to do in my region. Now, as a matter of fact, it's the best thing if you have an eye-to-eye talk about how things stand in your region. For example, if you take if you look at how much people pay for the utility bills, they tell me it's 96%. But then, what are the managing companies' debt to the suppliers and utilities? They tell me 1 billion ruble and 5 billion ruble of bad debt, and so on. But this is called stealing. And as soon as you begin calling a spade, some understanding arises. I hope next year you will show us a diagram with a line with an arrow going forward, going up. And indeed, it's a very good thing to compare the advantages and disadvantages. The joke that 1 year from now, Russia will buy the United States, but people like Zakharchenko continue to undergo searches. Now we are having Andrei Nikitin with us, the CEO of the Strategic Initiatives Agency. Now we have begun discussing the regional aspect. Do we need to bring the regions together and encourage them to work in a uniform way? I'll start from another subject. A couple of days ago, a high-placed official told me that you, I'm so bored with your road maps and plans. The investment climate is not becoming any better for them. Well, I was a bit offended. If it, I could have, I could understand that if a business person told me that. But if it is the responsible official, one in charge of the investment climate, is telling me this, it's a different matter. It does not mean we need to leave the administrative barriers the way they are today. We need to live in a country where it is easy to do business and where licensing is simple and comfortable. So we are going to carry on with this, and what the Agency for Strategic Initiatives is responsible for will carry it through. We will carry it through no matter what they say. Now about the uniform regional model. Dear colleagues, just think, we're having two people here, Vasiliev and Romanov, who rank eighth in the world by this indicator in one of the most complicated countries, not in Singapore or Switzerland or in Georgia, nor in Georgia, but in Russia. They rank eighth and want to move up still. Now, let me tell you how we're going to move forward using your example. We've conducted three rating efforts. We've accumulated best practices in, along with inexplicable practices when regional lawmakers added 60 days to the length of the wait for registration or licensing, and in 12 areas, including gas and water treatment and small businesses, we analyzed how the model worked, not at the federal level alone, but also at the level of municipalities. And other regional entities. And the Ross Register Agency, well, may do its part within 5 to 10 days, but at the municipal level, it may vary from 3 to 250 days, whereas some municipalities do not have the procedures in place at all. As regards small businesses, we conducted an inspection, a study, we clearly defined what we have and what it can be. We have built target models. We hope they will be considered by the State Council, and we want to tell the regions, no matter what your starting point is, by the end of 2017, your parameters should be exactly what the target plans are. And I do have the hope that we are going to achieve that because there are two interesting circumstances. All this activity will be carried out in the framework of a single project management program. It does not mean that someone is giving an assignment now and 1 year from now we will look at what we have. It means that we'll follow the progress every day, and when something doesn't happen, we will always have a chance to help and see that. And there will be training programs launched, the first wave in covering 33 regions is involving examinations to be held soon, and the same is going to take place online. After you listen to a lecture by a professor and complete a test, then based on the result of that test, you'll be told read these two books or read these eight books, depending on how you've replied. And this is what it's about. Now, do you know what the RANFEX training program is about? What they teach people is so-called soft skills. The biggest issue is that federal and regional and municipal authorities are never perceived as one team. They live in conflict and keep shifting responsibility, and the favorite scapegoat is the federal central authority. And when I was going to Sochi yesterday, I read reports from the trainees of the first wave. They said our main conclusion was that Rostregisters officials are people too, are human too, and you can interact with them as well. And it appears that you can follow the progress of a mayor on a daily basis. So we are planning to launch this on a larger scale. I hope we'll be supported in that, and I would like very much to remove all administrative barriers by the end of 2017. Of course, I realize that external rating lists are not always objectives, but you know, 51st place is no longer Zaire or the Congo. It's something like a lazy version of Italy, Portugal, and I think we should go further north and be comparable to some of the northern European countries. Thank you, especially when we talk about roadmaps and how they're implemented in every specific region. We try to compare regions in terms of their efficiency, and we try to get some feedback from them. And a lot can be said based on that about the governor's business models. Now we will go on discussing administrative barriers and the regulatory environment. There's a special roadmap that seeks to simplify the model and to improve the quality. We're having here Alexei Rybnikov, head of the analytical service of EY company. It's an international entity. So as a representative of such an entity, we would like to hear how internationally these roadmaps are assessed. Thank you. Indeed, 3 years ago, the roadmap for the improvement of the regulatory environment was adopted. E-documentation was the core of that program, of that roadmap, and administrative cost reduction by 20% was one of the major targets, and the share of e-documentation was to be brought up to 70%. A lot has been done in the past couple of years. A lot of restrictions on e-documentation were removed last year. Starting from July 2016, the federal law, Federal Law 306, relieved entrepreneurs of the need to submit documents already filed and at the disposal of officials, and also, which is more important, all courts can accept e-documents as proof or evidence. And the problem can be dealt with radically in a case integrated one-stop shop procedures are put in place.
So we had a survey among the participants of the Foreign Investment Council. We asked them on their attitude and perception of the progress. Almost 50% say that there's been positive progress. The other 50% say that the implementation in Russian regions has been poor. 72% of the respondents say that there's still problems with connecting to the grid. About 50% said that construction permits have been an issue. But there's been a positive feedback on registration of titles and property, and so there's just a few examples when there's been a problem, so more or less it's done with. We heard a lot of issues that we need to focus on water, our services, on sanitary control, industrial safety control, and natural resources exploitation. But we also ask another question: what is the main barrier? And certainly it's the human factor that has been named as the main barrier. So two-thirds of the companies said that the level of qualifications of the management companies and the culture of e-electronic paperwork has been a huge hindrance. Well, it means we need to do more training, right? We need to improve the expertise. There was another poll which was done by the Agency for Strategic Initiatives, but you know, they asked entrepreneurs whether they would still use the stamp, the rubber stamp, in their paperwork, because you can You have the right to not to use it, but most of them said they would still use it. So we need to raise awareness. We need to teach people the best practices. So we need to enlighten and educate everyone. We also had another question of whether entrepreneurs wanted to be engaged in public debate going further. And almost all of them confirmed that they wanted to take part in the public debate. Thank you so much. We also have a roadmap that was drafted recently, a number of these roadmaps. It doesn't mean they're less significant, but I mean, there's a roadmap on corporate governance. We have Denis Spyrians, head of corporate governance of Prosperity Capital Management, and he's also deputy head of the working group. Thank you so much. So I will briefly tell you on corporate governance roadmap. Corporate governance is a boring subject if you go into too much detail, so I'll be brief. We launched this initiative in 2011. They had the first draft. Some of them have been successfully implemented, but some documents, some initiatives have not been implemented, have been stalled due to administrative barriers. But sometimes different stakeholders have a conflict of interests. And that's why we've not been able to resolve these issues quickly. But we would like to praise the efforts of the Agency for Strategic Initiatives. Some of the old projects, which we thought would never be implemented, have been given a new lease of life. And new experts have joined in. They provided their own vision of the problems and of solutions. And we finally have some fresh ideas. And certainly the agency has been famous for moving new projects forward. Well, usually it's, you know, is accomplished in 6 months. So we hope that we hope the agency would help us put the projects forward and implement new ideas in a more successful, efficient way. So this new roadmap was just approved in the spring, and the goal was to push some of the old projects forward. There are two areas. One is to provide more transparency to contracts or with a conflict of interest, and that has to do with such a point as protection for minority shareholders. That's one of the measures tracked by the Doing Business rating by the World Bank, and we hope there's there'll be an updated one coming out soon. And there's another one which is very important for the business community, that's contracts between related parties. Investors have viewed this as very useful one. So they look at the significant, as they call it, material conflict of interest. It has to be passed by, these contracts have to be passed by the board of directors, by the shareholders' meetings. So there are another of other points on boosting transparency, for example, for investors and for the members of the board of directors, that will allow them to take more qualified managerial decisions and control the actions of the management board. The second part deals with the protection of dividends for shareholders. It's been positively viewed. The third group of issues is on responsibility of the controlling party. So that usually benefits corporate governance. We're talking about corporate responsibility. There's another issue, which is reorganization. The civil code introduced new mechanisms for reorganization in 2014, but they were not transferred to the law on corporate governance. And, you know, it has not been introduced. yet. And once these parts are transferred, incorporated into the law on corporate governance, then it's the investors and shareholders will be able to do their operations much faster and more efficiently. And finally, when we talk about protecting the rights of shareholders, that's the quasi-treasuries, you know, the quasi-treasury shares. You might have not heard about it. That's how you, how companies can control themselves using that quasi-treasury shares. But minority shareholders usually suffer from that. In most of the jurisdictions, quasi-treasuries are not used, are not allowed to be used. While here in Russia, it's allowed. And the experts have asked us about this. And we hope that the agency would be able to push that forward to resolve this issue. And this is the tangible reform that investors would hail. So we are expecting new results. And this is the roadmap. Thank you so much. I'd like to thank the colleagues from the agency once again. It's a difficult, tough job, but they're doing it. And we're now moving on to another topic, that's supporting exports. We have a lot of export potential despite the efforts by outside forces. We have a roadmap to support exports. So where things stand, I hope that Mr. Bakulin from the Bakulin Motors Group will give us some more details on that. I'd like to remind you that 18 months ago, the Leaders Club had a strategic session here in Sochi. We talked about five major challenges, five basic fundamental goals that we need to resolve to move our business forward. And one of the top five was to set up the Russian Export Center. So 18 months on, I am a customer of this center. So how fast we are from an idea to implementation. So how does it work? I have several deals with African countries. And we have now identified sources of financing, but we've been actively supported by the Russian Export Bank. And certainly, the work has been sped up after the center was set up. You know, they pamper us like children, and they nurture and help us in every way and guide us in every step. So I'll talk about money today, you know, to develop exports. It's very important to get support in every area. For the first time in history, we were issued 3 billion for certification of products so that it could be sold abroad. So we had a tender which was launched several weeks ago, and we'll see who wins in the couple of days. The Russian Export Center was set up initially to support SMEs exports, but right now we have big business, so most of the applicants are big business representatives. So let's wait and see who gets the financing, SMEs or majors. And also, my company is part of the investment project. We're building a huge plant in the Vladimir region. We have completed the first phase. We're starting to produce products for the domestic market. The second phase will produce products for exports. And the Russian Direct Investment Foundation was supposed to join in and co-finance this project. And all of the participants of this huge project and the Russian Export Center have been helping us. But I don't know what the Russian Direct Investment Foundation is doing. So we would like to understand if they are taking part in it. They have to be active and proactive. They shouldn't hide from us. They shouldn't escape us. So we've received support from everyone. But if we're talking about this Russian fund, then it's the other way around. So we've tried to be brief. Thank you so much for this input. It's really important to get that hands-on experience. Let's move back to what's happening in the regions. And we have a representative of the Leningrad region, Mr. Yalov, Vice Governor. I have the same question. How is the roadmap implemented in your region? What's your perspective? There are three points on how Russian regions could further promote the national enterprise initiative. We've removed a lot of barriers for businesses, but there are still major barriers for organizations that are supposed to help businesses. I'd like to go back to the roadmap that Sergei Pikin referred to. No network can build, no grid company can build new grids, so it can only give you access to existing grids. So to completely improve the situation for SMEs, for majors, we need to revolutionize the electrical grid system. Certainly, we can still enhance every roadmap so that these institutional organizations can improve their operations. I think the balance has shifted somewhat, and it's a bit absurd. You know, everyone has been criticizing monopolies and officials, but no one has actually raised the issue of the responsibility of businesses. Going back to the roadmap on electricity connection, have you ever wondered that when we introduce a fee for unused connection, what we have today is longer time to connect and high tariffs simply because someone's not using their connection?
And the same is true of various privileged categories, both individuals and businesses, because even if you get a benefit, you need to pay for what you use, and that's not something peculiar to all the roadmaps, but this is really typical. And thirdly, something which is typical to the implementation of all those roadmaps is that when we have done all the easy steps, made all the easy steps, and what remains are the complex ones, it's a challenge indeed. The High School of Economics has recently counted how many authorizations a local body should go through to get a law amended. It's 22 procedures, technically. If you look at other countries, the next most complicated country has 11 procedures, others have 7, 5, or 3. So for us to move on along those industry-specific roadmaps for the national business initiatives, we need to drop all kinds of authorization procedures. Why do we float all these documents and papers that we don't read but we have to sign? And we began in our oblast from two roadmaps, one for energy and the other for construction. But then we were confronted with the limitations of the governance system, and as we started the project office, we could see that one project was not sufficient, and we started to change the whole system of government programs for the region to live in accordance with the priorities defined by the strategy, not with the specific solutions that have to be chosen on an occasional basis. Permit me to take up what Dmitry Yalov has said. Yes, I know what you're going to talk about. Well, Dmitry Yalov has begun to talk about the issue of mobilizing investment. And I would like to share an astounding piece of news. Recently, the Leaders Club, jointly with Russia 24 TV channel, launched a new project entitled Business Agent, where entrepreneurs assess prospects for investment in a certain region. It has been started already, and let's see a video. This is a joint project of Russia 24 TV channel and the Business Association that goes to one Russian region every week. And the task of the team is to see how investors are welcomed there. We will show what an investor is confronted with during their first trip. They have to assess the regions by 75 parameters, including investment mobilization institutions, and ending with hotels and airport infrastructures. It takes account of everything that an investor will be faced with, and there were no signs to access the VIP area. Is this a five-star hotel? Well, this is the Nizhny Novgorod's best hotel. Special attention will be paid to the Regional Investment Mobilization Corporation. This includes three parameters: an assessment of the website. I entered Development Corporation, but for some reason it was from the Urals that I received I got a hit.
Okay, so what kind of production are you planning to organize?
И наконец третий параметр – непосредственно встреча с представителями корпорации.
And thirdly, a meeting with corporate representatives. People keep telling us that there's no possibility to connect to the infrastructure. Yes, this is a problem indeed. So an assessment of the development areas, business incubators, industry parks, and special economic areas, all of these are assessed, including access, utility lines, and the infrastructure. In Perm, be ready to this. This is the key to the toilet, and this is the toilet in the industry park. Now the smell hits, and it's a pity you can't film it. General development is important too. Roads, new neighborhoods, touristic attractions. This is one of the beautiful, most beautiful places in the world and has a great potential for domestic tourism. The entrepreneur will be visiting the region often, so good restaurants play an important role. Let's taste it. It's good enough. Now, the scale, well, the rating, the assessment is given on rating based on a 100-point scale. And where do we find happiness in Perm? Now, this is the new format of the Leaders Club rating effort, which we expect to present at St. Petersburg Economic Forum next year. But I won't tell you what those 30 regions are. Now, we are ready to become the 31st region, and if I can take 2 minutes of your time, there are two approaches. One is people are looking for better places, like it was in the 90s, people going to the Seychelles and Mauritius. And the second type of approach is to make things better around yourself where you are. So don't be afraid of the smells. Just come and change things and see what you get 1 year later. So yes, the things like the outhouse key with a bell. I hope they will change things. But the entrepreneurs themselves can make the change. Okay, let's go on with that. Thank everybody for listening and for saying things and stating your opinion.